attitudes. So if you could, if you have a mobile device and you could scan the QR code and take the survey if you haven't already done it, it's just two questions, it shouldn't take you more than 30 seconds. I really appreciate it if you could take the survey before we begin. At the very end, we'll take a look at the results. What I'm going to try and explain today is hopefully some information to help you better understand the differences between the various journals that we publish, both within Nature Research and BMC and Springer, and between the three groups. I'm hoping that you'll appreciate the increasing importance of doing research in the open, both to improve the quality and the rigor of your research, to make your research more useful, and through both of these things, to make your research have more impact. And finally, I'm going to try and give you a few pointers about how you could improve the impact of your writing, and that way also improve the impact of your research. Very briefly, so Springer Nature was formed in 2015 by the merger of Macmillan Publishers and Springer Science and Business Media. We brought together three great brands of scientific publishing: Nature Research, which publishes Nature, and Nature Physics, and Nature Genetics, and Nature Materials, and Nature Communications, Scientific Reports and Scientific Data. Springer, which publishes a range of the world's best scientific books and many journals, and BMC, which is one of the world's leading open access publishers in biomedicine and medicine and increasingly beyond. First, I'm going to talk about Nature Research. Now, what are the names of Nature Research branded journals looking for? We're looking to publish papers that are extraordinary. Publishing in a Nature journal starts not with the desire to get published in Nature, but with the discovery of something that you think is extraordinary, something that you want to tell the world about, because what Nature journals are looking for are to publish papers that elicit a certain reaction, a reaction that I can summarize in one word, which is, wow! Wow, I didn't expect this experiment to behave in this way, or I didn't expect this system to behave in this way. I didn't expect the universe to behave in this way, or for more technological advances. Wow, that's really clever. This enables us, this advance published here in this Nature paper, enables us to manipulate the world today or in the near future in ways that we couldn't do last week. Now, so, all major journals are looking to elicit a response of wow, so what's the difference between the Nature journals? The difference between the Nature journals is the audience. So Nature publishes all of the sciences. So the audience of Nature is all scientists. Nature seeks to publish papers that have the most significance that is apparent to the most number of scientists. And by that I mean the papers that we publish in physics, if the significance of those advances are explained to a chemist or a biologist should understand, I understand why that's important. I
understand why that's published in Nature.
That's not to say that a chemist or a biologist should be able to understand all the technical details or be able to reproduce the experiments, but they should appreciate the significance of the results of the papers that we publish in physics. Conversely, the papers that we publish in the life sciences, the significance of those papers should be apparent to someone working in chemistry or physics. Now, when I was an editor at Nature, I was handling submissions in physics. This was 15 years ago. One of my least favorite parts of the job was when physics papers would land on my desk and I would read them and think, this is some really lovely physics. Entirely arcane. Something I have no idea how I would explain this, the importance of this, to a chemist, let alone to a biologist. But it speaks to my inner physics geek. But because I can't explain why this is important to a biologist or to a chemist, it doesn't fulfill a key criteria of Nature, which is that its significance should be apparent to anyone. And I remember thinking, I wish there was another journal called, I don't know, Nature Physics, where I could publish this research. Back then, Nature Physics didn't exist. So I was having to reject these papers and they get published in physical review letters by our competition. Now, a similar problem had arisen in the late 80s and the early 90s in the life sciences. There was an explosion of research in the life sciences, and Nature was receiving an avalanche of really good life science research, in particular in genetics. And if at the time Nature had tried to publish all the genetics that was coming to us, it would have swamped the other disciplines of research. And Nature would no longer be Nature, it would become a genetics journal. So it was decided, well, rather than turn Nature into a genetics journal, why don't we launch a genetics journal, which is what we did in 1992 with the launch of the first sister title, Nature Genetics. And so Nature Genetics was launched to be able to provide a home for all the great genetics research that didn't quite make it into Nature, that didn't have the widest, most profound implications. And it was such a success. We repeated that success in many other disciplines. So the next one was Nature Immunology, and then Nature Cell Biology, Nature Medicine, Nature Neuroscience, Nature Molecular and Cell Molecular and Structural Biology. And then we started launching in the physical sciences. So first with Nature Materials, and then I got my wish to be involved in the launch of Nature Physics, where I could publish all those great physics papers, and Nature Nanotechnology, Nature Photonics, and so on. So these journals are looking to publish research that is of interest across those disciplines, but not necessarily beyond those disciplines. So in Nature Genetics, we publish papers that will be of interest to all geneticists. That's still quite a broad scope. So the papers that we publish in plant genetics, we would expect those papers, the significance of those papers, to be apparent to someone working in human genetics or microbial genetics. Cell biology is for papers that will be of interest to all cell biologists. Nature geoscience, to all geoscientists. Immunology, to all immunologists. Physics, to all physicists. Chemists, to all chemists. You get the idea. Now, in 2005, when we launched Nature Physics, it was glorious. Finally, I had somewhere where I could publish all the lovely physics that was coming to Nature that didn't quite make it into Nature. And I was really publishing everything that I loved. Everything that came through the door, I thought, this is a really lovely piece of physics. I now have somewhere to publish it. But we were so successful with the launch of Nature Physics that we attracted so much exceptional physics research. A few years later, around 2010, 2011, 2012, I was finding that I was having to reject more and more physics that I thought was really lovely physics, but it just wasn't the best of the physics that we were receiving. And I can remember thinking, I wish, well, really there should be another journal, another Nature journal, where we can publish this lovely physics that's maybe not as broad or as profound as the other stuff that I'm publishing in Nature Physics. Well, thankfully, in 2010, we did exactly that with the launch of Nature Communications. Nature Communications is where we provide a home for all the good science that doesn't quite make it into our other journals. Nature Genetics is for genetics that doesn't quite make it into Nature. Nature Communications is for genetics that will be of interest to a narrower group of people that doesn't quite make it into Nature Genetics. So Nature Communications will be for papers for genetic papers that appeal to, say, all plant geneticists, not necessarily all geneticists, or all virologists, and not necessarily all immunologists, or all organic chemists, not necessarily all chemists, or all volcanologists, not necessarily all geoscientists, or all plasma physicists, not necessarily all plasma physicists. So, these Nature journals with a Nature name in them, papers that will make someone, somewhere, think, wow. But there's another class of papers that are pretty good, that don't quite elicit that response, that reaction of, wow, but which are still important papers that deserve to be published somewhere that provides a good profile for that research, that ensures that people can see that research, find that research, and read that research. And so for those research papers that don't quite make it into Nature Communications, we launched three new titles last September for the Communications Journals. These are for publishing papers that are important to advancing particular problems within these research disciplines. So for example, research that will be of interest to people who are working on GABA receptors in the neocortex of mammals, or people who are working on calcium channels within the membranes of living cells, or people who are working on the development of techniques for asymmetric synthesis, that's to selective synthesis of chiral organic molecules, or Dirac fermions, this weird and wonderful type of excitation within condensed matter physics. So this is where we provide a home for things that don't quite make it into Nature Communications. We also have another suite of journals called the Nature Partner Journals. The Nature Partner Journals we've launched to try and support specific emerging communities, communities like the computational material science community, for which we launched NPJ Computational Materials, and we launched these in partnership with centers of excellence around the world. So we launched NPJ Computational Materials with the Shanghai Institute of Ceramics, or NPJ and Science of Learning, which we launched with the University of Queensland, or NPJ Precision Oncology, which we launched with the, I think it's the Hormel Foundation thing. And NPJ, biofilms and microbiome. Now what's interesting about this suite of journals is that the idea of NPJs was actually seeded by a Japanese journal, a journal that we launched in with Tokyo Institute of Technology, which was NPG Asia Materials. NPG Asia Materials was the sort of predecessor to our NPJ program, and it really set the idea of launching a journal in partnership with a center of excellence attached to the Nature name. And it celebrates its 10th anniversary this year. So here's a summary of what each of the journals is looking for, the differences between the different Nature journals, and where your different research might belong. Now finally, I'm going to quickly talk about BMC. BMC made history in 1999, the world's first dedicated open access publisher. It published its first journal in 2000, so well before many other people, well before Nature even. And at the top of the BMC pyramid are the BMC flagships. These are BMC Biology, BMC Medicine, Genome Biology, and Genome Medicine. And these are very selective journals that, look to publish papers that make people within these disciplines think well. So they're similar to the Nature journals. And beneath those, we have the PMC series journals. PMC series journals are to support all research that comes out of these more specialist areas of research. So not just the wow research, not just the pretty good research, but also the rigorous, systematic, some would say incremental research. So all research coming out of these communities, the BMC series journals seeks to publish. We also have the BMC academic journals, which are, again, these are journals that are run in partnership with institutes and scholarly societies around the world. And they're a mix of very selective journals and also sort of rigorous objective science journals. So I've spoken a little bit about open. Why do we care about open? Why should you care about open? Well, we care about open because we believe it's a large part of the future of publishing. We think, although it's still not yet in the majority of papers published under an open access license, we believe that the day is coming where the predominant amount of research is published in the open, under an open license. And we're very pleased that, Springer Nature is the biggest publisher of open access research. So in 2000, there were just a few. In 2018, everyone is publishing at least part of their research in the open. Why should you care about being open? Because it improves the impact of your research. It improves the breadth of, reading of your research. So when we launched Nature Communications, Nature Communications now is a fully open access journal, means everything that we publish is open access. But when we launched Nature Communications, we launched it as a hybrid journal. And that meant that about two-thirds of the research was published under a subscription license, about one-third was published under an open access license. And we asked an independent organization, the Research Information Network, to take a look at the difference in impact that the subscription articles were having compared to the open access articles. And they found that the papers that were published open were downloaded and read three times as often as those that were published under a subscription license, and cited somewhat more often, which I don't think is that surprising. But it's notable and it's important. It's how you can improve the impact of your research just by making sure that everyone has access to the research. Why else do we care about open? We think that openness is part of the solution to a critical crisis in science and science publishing, known as the reproducibility crisis. Now, we asked over 1,500 researchers about what we identify as this crisis, and more than a majority, 52%, recognized that reproducibility, or rather a lack of reproducibility in the published literature, is a problem that could be described as a crisis. We noted that 70% of the people we asked reported that at some time or another, when they tried to reproduce the conclusions of papers published by others in the literature, that at some time or another they'd been unable to reproduce the conclusions in the published literature. So this is 70% of researchers who tried at some time or another to, reproduce the literature. This is not to say that 70% of the literature is irreproducible. What I thought was really astonishing about this survey was that fully half of the people we asked said that at one time or another, when they tried to reproduce their own research, they'd been unable to reproduce the key conclusions of even their own research, which I think is astonishing. That tells you something about the depth of the problem that we're facing. Now, what I'm not talking about fraud. I'm not talking about results that are made up. I think that is a problem, but I don't think it's the biggest problem when it comes to reproducibility. I'm also not talking about papers that just turn out to be wrong. Most of what is published today, in 5, 10, 15, 20 years' time, will turn out to be wrong or incomplete. That's just how science works. That's how science is meant to work. But that's not what I'm talking about. What I'm talking about are results, experiments that are so poorly described that no one knows how to reproduce those experiments. They're unable to reproduce those experiments. It's about poor explanation about how the experiments were carried out. Or conclusions that are overstated, beyond which what the data supports. Or data themselves that have been misrepresented in some way. So, for example, cherry pickers. You do lots and lots of experiments, and you find some experiments that support your theory, support an interesting hypothesis. What about all the other experiments? You think, well, that experiment, I was drunk when I took those experiments, so let's ignore those data points. And those were collected by a student who I don't trust. So let's remove those data points. And let's just present these data points here. And I think we all do it. We all do that sort of thing to some degree or another. If you do it at one extreme, I think you could call that fraud. But most of the instances where we select what data we present, it's just how we do science. And I think, but I still think that is biasing the published record. Particularly as those bits that we've excluded are never published anywhere, and they're not available anywhere. And I think this is part of the problem. Finally, just sloppy science, I think, is contributing to this. Failure to account for sources of error, failure to include sufficient controls, poor use of statistics. And we think the problem isn't about too much open, but too little open. So in 2009, we published a study in Nature Genetics, which was an analysis of 18 previously published Nature Genetics papers. These were papers that were reporting microarray gene expression data. So the authors of this paper, they selected 18 papers from Nature Genetics, which should be, by all rights, examples of the best genetics research available at that time. And they tried to reproduce the key conclusions of each of those 18 papers. And what they found was that they were only able to reproduce two of the papers. The key conclusion, they were only able to fully reproduce two of those papers. Six of the papers they could partially reproduce, but the majority of those Nature Genetics papers, they could not reproduce the key conclusions of those papers. 10 of the 18. And what the researchers noticed was that those papers that they were able to fully reproduce were the papers that were the most open. They were the ones where, when the paper was published, the data from that paper was deposited in an open data server. They were the ones where the methods and the protocols were most fully described. And those papers that they couldn't reproduce were the ones that kept the data secret and that were less forthcoming about being fulsome in the description of the methods and the protocols used. So we believe that the solution, part of the solution, is to encourage scientists to be more open in the reporting of their research and more open in the sharing of the data from their research. One of the ways that we're trying to do this is through what's known as the reproducibility checklist. For many years, we have asked authors of life science papers to fill out a checklist for what they've done to try and improve the reproducibility of their research. We asked them to describe the sample size and how it was determined. We asked them to be forthcoming about certain data exclusions, what efforts they've made to replicate their experiments, what randomization they use, the whole slew of things. There's several pages of this. We've asked authors to tell us, to give us some sense of the reproducibility of the experiments that they're reporting. So we've asked them to supply this for many years now. But last year we decided, well, we've got all this data, but we've been keeping it on file. We haven't been telling anyone else about it. Last year we decided that actually, in the interests of transparency, we should publish these reproducibility checklists alongside the papers that we publish, so others can see the efforts that authors have gone to try and reproduce their own research. And also so that everyone can see both best practice and perhaps not so good best practice in terms of the research that we are publishing. Now, the other thing that I wanted to stress, so I come from Nature and I come from, you know, high impact factor journals and all that sort of thing. But one thing that we are keen for the world to understand is that high impact research isn't the only important research. That actually most progress in science is slow and steady and methodical and incremental. That in fact, most progress is reported away from nature. Nature reports the big jumps in new ideas and new concepts, but most of the actual progress happens away from the high impact factor journals. And one example of this that I'd like to give is the example of the progress in computer hard disks. This is a story that I stole or borrowed from Bernie Meyerson, the vice president of innovation at IBM. So, in 1956, IBM released the first commercial computer hard disk. Basically, the idea was you paint some magnetic paint onto a metal disk, and you store information in the polarization, magnetic polarization on that disk. That concept has not changed since 1956 for any magnetic hard disks. I'm not talking about solid state disks. That is a new innovation. But anything that you still uses a hard disk, and many do, I store most of my information on a home network server that's still magnetic hard disk. It's still using the same concept that was developed in 1956. In 1956, a hard disk weighed 1 ton. It cost $315,000. That's in today's money. It was slow, it used up a lot of electricity, and it stored 5 megabytes of information. 5 megabytes in a thing that's about this big. Since then, most of the progress has been slow and incremental and steady. There have been no real big jumps in computer technology. There's been a subtle change in the slope. That's basically the anisotropic magnetoresistant reed heads. It's probably the biggest innovation, but it wasn't a step change. It was just a change in speed of innovation. Most of this was slow and incremental. Now, if we decided that we weren't interested, the world wasn't interested in incremental change, incremental progress, how big do you think the hard disk in this computer here would be? Capacity of that computer, how big do you think it would be? Size of this room? Size of this building? More like the size of this campus. It would be the size of 4 aircraft carriers. Probably bigger than the size of this campus. That's how big that hard disk would have to be without incremental progress. Now, if cars had made the same sort of incremental progress, a 1956 Beetle would now weigh 400 grams, cost $5, have a top speed of 86 million kilometers an hour, and be able to travel 24,000 kilometers on a tank of gas. That's the importance of incremental progress. And so, we have to continue to support scientists in publishing both big advances and small advances. We shouldn't be providing more emphasis on the big advances. We should be supporting the small as well. And so, to try and support this, Nature has recently signed up to the San Francisco Declaration of Research, etc. BMC has also signed up to this, I should say. Nature and BMC have signed up to the San Francisco Declaration on Research Assessment, which is to say that Research should be judged on its own merits and not about the journals in which it's being published, not by things like impact factor. And so, to this, we feel that scientists should be supported in publishing in journals not just Nature, but also the BMC series, PLOS One, Helium, Scientific Reports, ACS Omega, journals where they are looking to publish rigorous science, not necessarily wow science. So Scientific Reports is an example of a journal that's looking to publish rigorous science, not necessarily wow science. So that's the difference. I often get the question, what's the difference between Scientific Reports and Nature Communications? Nature Communications is looking to publish papers that make someone think, wow. But Scientific Reports is there to ensure that we provide a home that supports rigorous, solid, objective research. And here are just some of the stats for Scientific Reports. In seeking to publish rigorous research, it rejects over 40% of what it receives. It only publishes 60%, and it publishes research from around the world. And even though we're not looking to publish high-impact research, much of what we do publish in Scientific Reports does still have impact and is recognized by Nobel Prize winners. And finally, BMC series is also a place where we publish, again, rigorous, objective research. But even so, there's still a problem. And the problem arises from any journal that only publishes research that's interesting. And I'll try and illustrate it using a comic that I adapted from XKCD, a story about jelly beans and acne. So imagine someone makes a claim that jelly beans cause acne. And someone does very brief research and says, no, they don't. There's no correlation between jelly beans and acne. And then someone says, maybe it's the color. Maybe it's the specific color that causes acne. And so imagine labs around the world, 20 different labs, choose a different color of jelly bean. And each of those labs seeks to try and determine whether that color of jelly bean causes acne, whether there's a link between those jelly beans and causes acne. My lab looks at purple jelly beans and finds no association between purple jelly beans and acne. Another one looks at brown jelly beans and finds no association. When I say no association, no correlation with a confidence level of 95%. P-value of 0.05, so about 1 in 20. Pink, no association. Blue, no association. Teal, salmon, red, turquoise, magenta. Yellow, no association, no association, no association, no association, no association. Gray, no association. Tan, no association. Cyan, no association. Green, the lab that was looking at green jelly beans has found an association between green jelly beans and acne, with confidence level of 95%. Mauve, no. Beige, no. Lilac, no. Black, no. Peach, no. Orange, no. Now, think about what each of these scientists is thinking when they find their result. Do you think that the people who found that there's no association between lilac jelly beans and acne, are they thinking, we have to publish this somewhere soon? Probably not. They're probably going to think, that's not interesting. We don't expect an association between acne and lilac jelly beans. It's not an interesting result. I'm not even going to bother writing it up. But the green guys, what's going to be the outcome of all of these experiments? A Nature paper that declares association between green jelly beans and acne, because that association is unexpected. That association is interesting. And because the editors and other scientists, the referees, will see that association with a confidence level of 95%, but they won't have seen all these other ones. All of these other studies don't get published. They don't get publicized. They might as well not exist. So all we see is that. But the thing is, if you do 20 experiments on a random number generator, there is a 75% chance that one of those experiments will yield a positive correlation with a confidence level of 95%. You're almost guaranteeing a false positive. And so Well, the problem is with journals that only want to publish interesting papers, they are favoring false positives. Because if you're going to publish only publish interesting papers, you're never going to publish any of these. You're only going to publish that one. And that's the bias, the unwitting bias in favor of false positives is part of the irreproducibility problem. You're not going to be able to reproduce that result because it's not a real result. It's just statistics. And so, what we feel we need to do is not try to encourage people to write papers on negative results. We need to provide more venues for disseminating negative results. And so one of the things that we're trying to do is to create a platform, which is called BMC Research Notes, which is a platform for research outputs that are not full papers. They're for research outputs that are smaller than full papers, that don't necessarily have novel conclusions, but which are potentially useful. So you could publish research proposals in BMC Research Notes, but you haven't yet had the chance to pursue experimentally. Now the negative results you could publish in BMC Research Notes. It doesn't have to be a full paper. Additions to established methods, confirmations of previous work, experiments that didn't quite work out, algorithms that didn't produce the results you wanted, and other hard-earned lessons from your research you could publish in BMC Research Notes. Now, there's another thing that we're trying to do to improve our confidence in the published literature, and that is provide new ways or new types of research paper. What I'm going to talk about here is called a registered report. Now, one of the challenges that has been noted is that there have been many studies that suggest that when a referee receives a paper that reports an extraordinary result, the referee wants that to be true, on average. Most referees, when they see an extraordinary result, they go, wow, I hope this is true. And just the act of hoping this is true means that they tend to be less rigorous in scrutinizing the experiments that produce these results, which is counterintuitive. It's a cliche to say that extraordinary results demand the most extraordinary evidence, but there is analysis of the published literature suggests that that's actually not true, that the most extraordinary results are subject to less scrutiny than more average results. And similarly, imagine you're a referee and you believe that the world is a certain way. You have a certain expectation for how the world is. And a paper lands on your desk and it presents data that confirms your worldview. It's just human nature that you'll probably want that to be true because you already believe it to be true. And so you'll be less critical of the experiments that produced those results. And the converse is true. If you believe the world is a certain way, and you see data that negates your worldview, you're going to be extra critical of those experiments. So what we're trying to do with registered reports is remove the focus from results, or rather move the focus from results onto experiments. We'd like referees to be spending most of their time telling us whether they think the experiments being proposed are the right experiments to answer a certain question. And so we are accepting, many of our journals are now accepting registered reports, which are formed by, say you have an interesting question. You think, well, that's an interesting idea. I wonder if the world works like that. I wonder if this is true. And then we would encourage you to think of experiments. We would answer the question, I wonder if this is true. And think about, okay, what are the statistics that we're going to use? What controls are we going to use? What is the threshold that we're going to say, if our data exceeds this threshold, then we'll say that the answer is yes, and if it doesn't, then we'll say the answer is no, or ill-defined. And then we'd encourage you to write all that up, and before you do a single experiment, write all that up You send it to one of our journals that accepts registered reports. We send that to the referees, and we ask the referees, is this an interesting question? Are the experiments the right experiments to answer this question definitively? Are the controls appropriate? Are the statistical methods appropriate? And do you believe that if their results exceed this threshold or don't exceed this threshold, it will give us a definitive answer to the question, or a definitive answer to the question? And if the answer to all those questions is yes, we will agree to publish the paper. We won't publish in principle. We won't publish it right there and then. We then ask the authors to go away, do the experiments, include the experiments in the paper, and then submit the full paper. Then we'll go back to the referees and we'll say, do these experiments live up faithfully to the experiments they said they were going to do in the first round of review? And if the answer to that is yes, we will publish the paper, regardless of what the answer is. We don't care whether the answer is yes or no, because we know that the experiments are appropriate to answering the question, and this gives us a much more confident answer to the question, because we know that the referees are not biased by the results, because they agreed to publish the paper before they saw the results. So this is a way of improving the robustness of the published literature. We have 8 journals that will accept registered reports. The only Nature journal at present that accepts registered reports is Nature Human Behavior. That's because the idea of registered reports was born out of the cognitive neuroscience and psychology community. But in addition, BMC Biology and BMC Medicine, the 2 flagship BMC titles, are accepting registered reports beyond the realms of cognitive psychology. BMC Ecology, one of the BMC series journals, is accepting registered reports in the context of ecology. And 4 of the Springer journals in cognitive neuroscience and psychology are accepting registered reports. But what about the data themselves? The most important currency in science increasingly isn't papers, but data. The data that underlies those papers. And publishing research without data isn't science. It's advertising. There are many benefits. I'm not going to go into all of these. There are many benefits to sharing more data. One of the benefits is economic. So the Human Genome Project is arguably the largest ever embarked upon open research project. And a study found that the Human Genome Project helped generate $1 trillion of economic activity in terms of new business opportunities, new scientific centers, new understanding, new opportunities, new technologies. And this was off the back of an investment of $1.4 billion. $1.4 billion sounds like a big number, but $1 trillion is an even bigger number. This is a 178-to-1 return on investment, and that would not have been realized had the Human Genome Project not been carried out in the open. I truly believe that. Because if they had wanted to keep it secret and keep it to themselves, keep it proprietary, they wouldn't have as many people working on exploiting the opportunities that the Human Genome Project offered. Also, there's a study to suggest that studies that are carried out with a view to giving away the data tend to be twice as productive. They produce twice as many papers as studies that keep the data secret. So this is a study of 7,000 ASF and NIH grants, and they found that those grants that embarked upon a project where they were going to give the data away were twice as productive. And I think the reason for that is that if you're going to give your results away, you want them to be useful to someone else. And so you take greater care in collecting the data and formatting the data and tagging the metadata of your data. You take greater care with your data so that other people will find it useful. But if you've taken care to make sure that your data is useful to others, it actually becomes more useful to yourself. And I think this is the reason why projects that are done in the open tend to be more productive than projects that are done keeping the data a secret. There are also many studies showing that if you post your data to an open data server at the same time you publish a paper, on the back of that data, your paper gets many more citations than if you wanted to keep the data secret. And that makes sense, because if you publish the data with your paper, or if you make your data available at the same time as your paper, the paper becomes more useful. And if it's more useful, it'll make more impact. If it makes more impact, it will be cited more often. Now, our sharing policy is that if you publish a paper with Nature and someone asks you for the data, you have to give them the data. You don't necessarily have to put it on an open data server. If someone asks you for it, you have to provide the data. The same is true of other materials, code, protocols, cell lines, and what have you. So to try and encourage more data sharing, and to ensure that our policy on sharing data is clear, we're now requiring, in Nature and BMC actually, we're now requiring all papers to be published with a data availability statement. This statement is, if you give your data away, if you put your data on an open data server, the data availability statement is where you can point readers to the server. If you don't want to give your data away, and that's fine, we're not requiring people to open up their data, if you don't want to give that data away, then the data availability statement says, if you want my data, this is the person to email. So it helps the readers know how they can get hold of your data, should they want to get hold of your data. But what we're increasingly finding is that the biggest hurdle to more data sharing is not that people don't want to, it's that people don't know how to. They don't even know where they would share their data if they were going to share their data. How it could be, where would they put it for other people to be able to discover it, to be able to find that data. And for this reason, we've launched two new initiatives. The first is the open data, the research data help desk. This is a free service to help authors, not just of Nature papers or BMC papers, help authors of in any journal understand where they should be putting their data. So genomes, there are very specific community repositories where they should be putting their data. Certain types of neuroscience data. Similarly, there are community set up databases, structured databases, where you would put your data. But most data, there aren't yet community databases. So we would recommend another unstructured database. There are many around, one of which is FigShare. And so we try and answer questions at the help desk within 2 business days. It's run by members of the Springer Nature data publishing team. This is a center of excellence where we try to bring data scientists into the company to help us help our authors better structure and better share their data. And these are guys who run another initiative, which is the Springer Nature Research Data Support Service. This is a nominally paid for service where we will help you structure your data to make it more discoverable, to make it more useful, to make sure that you're not breaking the law, and to make sure that your data has more impact in the same way that we will, will copy edit your paper if you submit it to a Nature journal. We will help essentially copy edit your data to ensure that it has more impact. And again, we don't care what journal you're going to publish in on the back of this data. This is just for your data wherever you publish. And what we're trying to do, so most open data is very poorly shared. It's usually like a zip drive. It's just a data dump, which is of no use to anyone because it's very difficult to know what's in there, what it's about, what it relates to. I don't know what species of mongoose, what the banded mongoose, but
I don't know what the Latin name is, I don't know where the obvious is from, I don't know who collected it, I don't know when it was collected, it's just a data dump. So what our services try to do is turn this into this, which is a much more information-rich, useful data descriptor. It has all the metadata, it says who it was that collected the data, when it was collected, what papers cite the data, use the data, and it creates a DOI so that other people, if they use the data, can write papers and make sure you get credit for this data. And here's an example where we've used our services on a Nature paper. So here's the Nature paper. It was about prehistoric fish. It was imaging, 3D imaging of prehistoric fish bones. So there's the Nature paper. There's the data availability statement telling people how they can get the data. And here's the Figshare portal, the Springer Nature Figshare portal, where people can find the description of the data. And it contains, so this is just a section, or rather a projection of the three-dimensional CT scanning data of these bones. And you can go to this site, and if you have the right software, download the data and really see in great detail the contours and shape in three dimensions of these fish bones. And it's something that really turbo boosts the impact of this paper. If we just published this paper, it would have a certain amount of impact. But this makes this paper much more useful to our readers, much more useful to scientists. Helps it make more impact. So what's true about papers is also true about data. I told you that what our journal attempts to do is to curate papers. We also now believe that data also deserves to be curated. It deserves to be clear. It deserves to be discoverable. It deserves to have peer review so that we are confident in what the papers mean. And these are the FAIR principles. And the FAIR principles are the sort of standard principles that we apply to papers, but applied to data. This is one of the reasons why we launch scientific data. Scientific data publishes descriptions of data that have been rigorously peer-reviewed. And this was our first initiative to improve the sharing of data and improve the utility of data. So we published descriptions. This is what the structure of a typical data descriptor, and the key information is here. And one thing to note about a data descriptor is that it doesn't attempt to answer a novel question. It's not about testing a scientific hypothesis. It's simply to describe how the data was collected, the experiments, the metadata, to make that data useful. It's not trying to put forward a scientific hypothesis. We still believe that's what scientific papers should be for. So it's a complement to scientific papers, not a replacement of scientific papers. And again, showing your materials is just as important. Cell lines, protocols, code, and so on. So that's how you improve the impact of your research through more sharing. How do you improve the impact of your research through the way that you write your research? The first rule when you write anything is think of the reader. This rule is important whether you're writing a postcard, or a letter, a birthday card, or an email, or a scientific paper. Most important when you write a scientific paper is to think of the reader. They're the most important person in your life. Rule two is think of the reader. It's that important, and you can probably guess what rule three is, which is think of the reader. What do I mean when I say think of the reader? I mean make their life easy. Don't try and impress them with your vocabulary because that makes their life difficult. Science is difficult. Science is complex. When you write a scientific paper, most of the time, you're trying to simplify very complex concepts. Don't make that more difficult by using very complex language.
Now, of course, you need to use particular technical terms that are relevant to your field of study. They're always technical terms. But there's a whole bunch of language that's not technical that you will be using as well. And I think the approach to that, I think best summarized by this Asian philosopher, which is that language is simply required that it convey meaning. Meaning will be complex, the words should not be complex. What do I mean? What's an example? One example I give, one example that gets up my nose, this is a word that's used far too often in scientific papers. The word is utilize. Now, we all know what utilize is. We know what it means. But it's unnecessarily complex. It's not that complex, but it's unnecessarily complex. Utilize. Utilize. Three syllables. A whole bunch of letters. And the reason that irritates me when I see utilize used all over the place is because there's a much better word to use. It's use. It's only three letters. It's one syllable. When you read it, your eye jumps over it, and it's there, it's done. You know, you understand the meaning with one syllable, in a snap. Utilize, your eye is thinking, your brain is thinking. It takes three times the effort to read the word utilize as it takes to word the word use. That's what I'm talking about. Utilize sounds more scientific. It sounds more technical and more impressive. But it's the same meaning. So you should always prefer use. Now, not always, not necessarily always. If you use a lot, it can be repetitive. So then we use this, and then we use the other, then we use the other, then we use the other, then we use the other. You could throw in a couple of utilizers in there. So you could use this and that, and then we utilize this, and then we use that, and then we use that, and then we use the other. What I don't want you to do is say, utilize this, and then we utilize this, and then we utilize the other, and then we utilize this thing, and then we use this thing. Always choose the simpler, smaller word over the more complex, more difficult word, because it will help bring out the meaning. You will be considered to be clever and intelligent by the ideas that you're explaining on the page, not by the flouncy language that you're using. Now, when you start a scientific paper, when you start writing anything, you start by introducing the context. The context is where you explain what the problem is, or you set the scene. And this is where mostly you want to say why it is that what you're working on is important. Now, the biggest mistake that people make, or the most common mistake that people make, that I think, okay, why is this research important? There are lots of people working on this problem. That must be the reason why this paper is important, because there are lots of people working on this problem. And so they start there. So when I was an editor for Nature Physics and Nature Communications, I was handling an area of science, material called metal organic perovskites. And almost every paper that I read started with the sentence, metal organic perovskites are an important new class of materials that have stimulated profound interest by a large number of researchers. I don't care. And most of the readers don't care either. It doesn't matter how many people are working on it. That doesn't tell the reader why the field is important. The reason the field is important is the reason why there are all those researchers working in the field. And if you don't already know about metal organic perovskites, that sentence doesn't tell you anything. And if you are, doesn't matter. Much better would to explain why there are so many researchers working on metal organic perovskites. So a better introduction to all of these papers would be, the performance of solar cells based on metal organic perovskites has recently surpassed that of many other types of solar cell. Metal organic perovskites can be grown on inexpensive substrates using solution-based techniques, which could reduce the cost of solar cells. Anyone, a biologist, a chemist, a physicist, a geoscientist, will understand why metal organic perovskites are an important area of research from that, and they have no idea from that. And that's how you make an impact. You explain why it is that these things are important. You don't just declare that they're important. Now, this is the most important slide. All right, this one and the next two slides are the most important slides in this whole talk. Because the sentence that begins, "Here we show," is the most important sentence in your paper. It should appear about three or four sentences in. It could be five or six, but ideally about three or four sentences in into the abstract or the first paragraph. What comes after "Here we show" should be something extraordinary. You should say, "Here we show something extraordinary." And I don't mean the word "something extraordinary." This is where you insert the extraordinary thing that you've discovered. What's not extraordinary is the fact that you've done some experiments. This is not where you tell people about your experiments. You tell people about your experiments after this sentence. And it doesn't have to be immediately after, but it should be after this sentence. People want to know, as soon as possible, what is the extraordinary thing that you've discovered. Scientists, researchers, are busy people. They don't have time to be reading about your experiments for you to tell them what's the extraordinary thing you've discovered. They don't care about your experiments. I don't care about your experiments. Or at least not until you tell me what you've discovered. So, don't describe your experiments. Don't say, "Here we report experiments that are conducted to explore the role of bee counts in the thalamic health of brown rabbits." Boring. "Here we report polarization-dependent angle results, photo emission spectra, sulfur calcium peroxide films." Now, the alternative to this is not to add more exciting sounding words. So similarly, don't try and impress the reader that your research is important without telling them about what your research is, about what you've discovered. So don't say, "Here, for the first time, we report a breakthrough in the treatment of the atomic health of brown rabbit. What's the breakthrough? Why won't you tell me?" Or, this is a typical physics example from the world of high-temperature superconductivity. "Here we shed important light and report a paradigm shift in the understanding of the exotic mechanisms that drives the rich physics that govern the superconducting behavior of nanocrystalline mantle and sulfur calcium peroxide superconductors." Boring. It sounds impressive, but it really isn't. And people will just... they'll read this and they'll think, "I've got better things to be doing." And they'll go read something else. So better is you tell them exactly what you've discovered. What is the extraordinary thing that you found when you did your experiments? "Here we show that beta-carotene can improve the short-distance eyesight of myopic brown rabbits by up to 20%. It's obvious to everyone why that might be an important result. "Well, here we report results that suggest that superconducting properties of lanthanum-based cuprates are the result of spin orbit coupling." Now, you probably need to be a physicist to understand the full weight of what that means, but I've included it to give an example of, here we show results that actually resolve a problem, or actually present what is the resolution of that problem. They say the resolution of the problem is this. Not "we find a resolution," they say the resolution is this. Superconductivity in the lanthanum-based cuprates is the result of this thing over here, spin orbit coupling. How does your research build on previous research? It doesn't exist in a vacuum. And how does it? Give me numbers. Give me numbers about how your research advances our understanding or our technology. So don't use ill-defined adjectives. "We drastically increase the properties of widgets," or "we profoundly improve the treatment of nearsighted retinas." That sounds like hyperbole to me. But more to the point, what you think is drastic, possibly I don't think is drastic. And I will go reading, as an editor, I will go reading through the paper to try and find out what it is you think is drastic. You can't pretend, you can't pull the wool over my eyes that 0.1% improvement is drastic just because you call it drastic. Because I'll go looking through the paper to find out what you mean by drastic, And when I see that what you mean by drastic is 0.1%, I'm going to think, reject. Almost immediately. Profoundly improve. What's profound? What you think is profound may not be what I think is profound. So tell me what it is you think is profound. So much better would be to say exactly what it is that you've achieved. We increase the yield strength of the plastic widgets to 75 megapascals. Now, most people won't know what that means, so provide the context for what it means. More than twice the value reported previously. What would be even better is if you then go on to say, by improving the strength of plastic widgets, we can now make car engines or something else. Provide some context for where we can go next as a consequence of this increase. Well, here we show the beta carotene increases the eyesight of ground rabbits by up to 20%. So up to 20% is much better than more profound because it tells the reader exactly what you've done. In figures, clarity is more important than beauty. Don't try and make your figures look pretty. Try and make them look clear. So don't include lots and lots of different colors unless the inclusion of color makes them more clear. Don't try and make the data look cleaner than when you collected it at the bench. Try to ensure that your figures are clear and to the point. Try to ensure that what your figure is trying to say is obvious from a single glance. And conclusions, be specific. Don't say generalizations such as, our results shed light on X. Almost every paper ends with our results shed light on X, which don't tell us really anything about what your results tell us. So tell us what your results tell us. For example, our results suggest that lighter dongles increase the efficiency and speed with which widgets operate. What are the implications of your result? What are the concrete implications of your research that doesn't apply to every other paper in the universe? If you put it in a sentence that could apply to any paper in the universe, it's a waste of space. Tell me exactly what your results mean for this field and where we're going to go tomorrow. Finally, ORCID. Now, this actually is more important to audiences in China. Because in China, everyone has the same name. well, more or less. So the ORCID Open Researcher and Computer Identification Database is about ensuring that you get credit for your research. Everyone gets the right credit for their research. Now, what problem? So the ORCID database contains about 10% of the world's scientists. And the ORCID database contains 630 entries by scientists called Wang Wei, which means that there are 6,000 scientists in the world who have the same name, Wang Wei. Now, I'm reading a paper by Wang Wei, and I want to know, who is this clever chap called Wang Wei? And your name is Wang Wei. How am I to know that this Wang Wei, that you, the Wang Wei that you are, is the same as the Wang Wei on the paper that I'm reading? There's no way of me knowing that unless you went to the ORCID website and it took 30 seconds to register for an ORCID ID. And then supply that ORCID ID to all the publishers that you publish with. And they will attach that ORCID ID, either they'll publish it, they'll print it, or they'll attach the metadata in your paper. And that way it'll ensure when I click on that link, when I look for that ORCID ID, I find the exact one way that I'm looking for that was responsible for this paper. So the way of ensuring that you get credit for the research that you do. Now, many publishers now make this mandatory for many of their authors, including AAAS, AGU, EBI, FEMBO, Hindawi, IEEE, PLOS. We are currently in the midst of a trial of requiring it for corresponding authors for some of our journals. And so far, the feedback we've got is very positive. So it looks like we will continue that trial and probably roll that out. So eventually, you're probably going to need an ORCID ID, so go get one now. Right, now, I'm at the end. But I want to survey you one more time. I want to see if I've changed any minds. Please, can you take the survey again? Two questions, 30 seconds. Now lift up your phones, take the survey one last time, and I'll try and see the results. Once you've finished, then we can go to questions.